Glad to be of help. Are you showing that?
No, just the audio. All right, so we actually are live, Calvin.
Okay.
Now,
hi, Jeffrey.
Everybody can see you right now. And I'm going to make it so they can see both of us. Okay. And there. Now, okay. So now on your the window that you're seeing, you're watching me. You also should be able to see the stream I'm showing. There's two little, you can see a little window that's showing both of us and your name underneath you. Do you see that?
I see that. I see that.
So that's what everybody's seeing.
Okay.
They're seeing both of us. And then when you start getting really serious, then I will do this and make everybody see just you.
Is there anything in my teeth?
Not yet. No, okay. No. Well, you haven't eaten dinner yet. So because you're going to have dinner in a few minutes, then, you know.
Okay. Yeah.
So why didn't you just eat while we talk?
No.
Calvin.
I don't think so.
Well, thank you for
don't think so.
Thank you for being here with me. You know, I got to say, as much as I give you such a bad time all the years that I've seen you, it really was always good to see you because you welcomed me warmly, even though I gave you a lot of shit when I walked up.
That you did, Jeffrey. I forgive you.
Yeah, well, that's a good thing. Because and the thing is, and now I realize I've put two and two together, you aren't nearly as old as I always said you were.
I knew it, this
was the thing that I would say to you. You know, Calvin, when I was two, the first record I bought, you were singing on it.
Yeah, you sure did.
That was always the thing.
Yeah, that was your joke. Yeah, you sure did.
But this is the point, and why I always thought of you as being somebody that has been in the music business and with a singing family is because, in all honesty, one of the first records I bought was an Azteca record, and your sister Linda was singing on it.
Right.
Okay. And so I recognized the name, and then over the years you sang with Coke and some and Bill Summers, you said, we'll get to that in a minute. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. I knew about Linda and then all you, and you were, everybody thought of you as a singing family, like the
yeah, exactly. And we are. Yeah.
And you guys sang on lots of things that maybe mm-hmm. nobody even knew you sang on.
Right.
I mean, what was the first record that you sang on that? Now, Linda started singing a little before you, right?
And
And then did she bring you in to sing on something, or did
how? Absolutely. And that first, you have that Coke. If I ever lose this heaven.
Okay, I'll look for that so I can play it at some point.
What happened is that was a project that Pat Gleason from the Different First Studios, I don't know if you know who that was,
no.
In San Francisco. And Mercury Records and Coke had got a deal. And they wanted to do some music on that. And there was a song by Leon Ware. Great Leon Ware, great songwriter. And he wrote this song, If I Ever Lose This Heaven. It was recorded by Coke, The Average White Band, and Quincy Jones, all at the same time.
Oh, that's the same song that The Average White Band did.
Exactly. Okay. So that's that song. And that's, so they, you know, she called me, and I was doing working with a top 40 band that I worked with for a long time. And she said, Calvin, why don't you go over to the studio and put a track on this particular song. They've been auditioning singers to do it. Nobody's done anything that really kind of worked for that. And I just went over and just did what I could do with it. And I got in there with Pat, and he said, "Well, let's try this this tune." And it's sort of a Larry Graham kind of groove there, that feeling I had for that song. And I put it on there, and they dug it. And that's history.
Okay, so I'm actually looking for that.
Okay.
There it is. Okay, so I'm going to maybe play a little bit because I want to hear it. Okay. Coke Escovedo, "If I Ever Lose This Heaven," should be...
If you're fooling, only fooling, all I ask is why. If you're playing, then all I'm saying, feeling sure can lie. Fascinating, how fascinating, on the dark side of the moon. How exciting, then I'm still writing the book of love called you.
All right, I want to stop it for a minute, though. So, first, why didn't you ever sing that good in my band? With you, man. No, that sounded great. And did Linda sing some of all those backgrounds and stuff?
That's Linda singing the lead there with the Tillman singers,
uh-huh.
And also Harvey Mason on drums.
Really?
Yes.
Oh man,
that was a great song. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I love that song.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great song. And so that was the first record you did.
No, actually, I did some local things. I actually did a record with a guy from Oakland, Marvin Holmes. West Oakland has a great history of R&B music. And this guy, Marvin Holmes and the Uptights. And I did a record with him. That was the first record I remember doing. That was back in early 70s, but wow. from there I started, you know, working with a lot of top 40 bands and stuff like that.
Well, there's a lot of those kinds of bands in the Bay Area that just work all the time. Well, it used to be. How easy was it to work in those days when you first started singing? Like, was there lots of gigs?
Yeah, actually, I had a pretty popular band that we did a lot of stuff in the area, but that was the 70s area. So that was a big band kind of thing. There were bands everywhere, actually. Now, as far as gigs, I mean, that depended on how popular you were, how many gigs you could get. But go ahead,
Calvin. Could you tilt your camera back again so I can see your face more?
Okay.
There you go. There you go. Well, when did you start singing with Bill Summers?
You know, actually, right after Coke. And
okay.
I started working with Bill, and someone said Bill was in, I didn't know he was living in Oakland. And of course, you know, he came from the Headhunters with Herbie Hancock.
Right.
And he was looking for a singer, a lead singer, to form this new group. And he had just signed with MCA Records. No, a Reprise, I'm sorry. At that time. And I did the audition, and you know, the rest was history with that. We did about four albums. I'm sorry.
Yeah, and were there hits? I mean, you were on
Soul. We had a couple of hit songs. The first one was written by Kevin Tony of the Blackbirds. And he actually played and wrote that first song. You can call it what you want. And I went on and did four albums with Bill.
Wow.
So we eventually went to MCA Records.
Okay. And that was in the early 80s?
Exactly. Yeah.
And so the style of music then was kind of like you mentioned the Blackbirds, and that's when Kool and the Gang was kind of being kind of pop like.
Well, Bill Summers coming from the Herbie Hancock was more of a jazz influence, African jazz kind of thing, you know, that what he was into.
Right.
And when this group eventually got this deal with MCA, it became more of an R&B kind of thing. So oh. That's when William Kennedy joined the group. The Yellow Jackets. He and the great Larry Batiste and Clay Tobin. These are the guys that worked that group. And it became an R&B act.
So on the video that I was watching, when you were on Soul Train, you were on the end. I could tell it was you. And I didn't really know you could really dance that well. I didn't.
Once upon a time.
So it was you and who was the lady singing?
Her name is Lori Ham.
Okay. And but the other, it looked like all the band guys sang too.
Well, that's Larry Batiste.
Okay.
Clay Tobin Richardson. You know, I'm sure you know about those guys from Oakland. Oakland's the finest.
Yeah.
Songwriters and stuff. And a lot of people came through that group. I mean, you know, there were Michael Sasaki was the guitar player from the Cold Blood.
Cold Blood.
Ray Oviedo. Let's see, Tom Poole actually played trumpet with that group at one time. Like as I said before, Will Kennedy of the Yellow Jackets. And I don't know if you know Paul Van Wageningen.
Yeah, I actually had Paul that played this.
Paul's passed away. You had his brother, Mark.
Not Paul. Paul. I had Mark. Yeah.
So those are some of the guys that came through that group. So that was a special situation there.
I'm sorry. I was thinking of Mark, but Paul, I remember watching Paul play. Mm-hmm. And man, that guy was such a good player.
It was awesome.
Wow. And Will Kennedy, I've sent him an email. I'm hoping I can get him on the show too.
Mm-hmm.
There's a whole group of, I don't know if your iPad likes me. This is like,
I don't know if it likes me. It keeps falling down here.
Sorry about that.
I'm trying to hang in there.
Your iPad's going, hey, Calvin, man. It's like, you know, I don't know about talking to this guy. You should let's go, Calvin.
I'm here.
But there is such a rich history of music in Oakland where you're from and all of those people you're mentioning and those bands that I don't really know a lot about other than just working kind of with all you guys. And I've never, all the information I've gotten from it is just from talking to you and other guys like, oh, what was that like? Who was in that band? And so that's why I'm, what was it? The music scene then was pretty rocking.
Actually, I'm from San Francisco.
Oh, okay. No.
No, we're from San Francisco. Linda and I, and Fred Ross, and Martha Wash, and Victor Willis of the Village People. We had a very rich history in San Francisco as well.
Oh, okay.
So we just kind of incorporated that with Oakland folks as well. But yeah.
Well, you know, for me, this is just me thinking because I don't know anything, right? I'm a white guy from Nebraska, and I'm buying all these records. To me, there was an Oakland sound which sort of encompassed the entire Bay Area.
Exactly, but we were a part of the soul rock hippie movement kind of thing. So we had a greater wide influence of music between Oakland and San Francisco.
Yeah, and there was another. There were actually more than just the R&B. You know, there was a really rich rock.
Absolutely.
You know, with Jefferson Airplane and you know all those bands.
Yep, and then Bill Graham was the big guy here at that time, the Fillmore Auditorium, and that's where all the big concerts, all the big acts came, and it was very unique the way they put rock acts with R&B acts.
Yeah.
On the concerts. Yeah. It was.
What was the first, what was the first concert you went to?
When I was a kid, I went to see James Brown, I remember, at the Fillmore Auditorium.
Nice.
Yeah. And that, I think that was my first concert I remember going to. Of course, I used to go to concerts because my sister Linda was, she was actually a mini rock star herself there. So she was on a lot of bills herself with as a Loading Zone. That was the name of her group.
I saw a record. When I was flipping through, I noticed that she has some stuff out.
And yeah, the Loading Zone was a group that she worked with back in the 60s.
Okay, and so that was all during that time period between 68 and 74. You know, maybe 70.
Okay.
That there's a whole time period there that the Bay Area music scene was just blowing up.
Oh yeah.
Right. Okay. And so you kind of grew up and kind of experienced that's kind of how you were growing up through that.
All of that kind of stuff. So that we were fortunate to have all those influences to mold us into all the different singers and entertainers that we are out here and from the Bay Area.
Well, and so were you a musical family? Were your parents musical? Did you get taught that?
Linda and I, that was, you know, music was a part of our family as children. And what we would do, Linda, myself, my brother, and my cousin, we would, like on Saturdays and Sundays, we would actually put on the show for all the uncles and uncle and aunts and that would come over and they'd have dinner and stuff. And we would entertain them. We would put on capes and imitate James Brown, and we do Gladys Knight and the Pips and and that was all the stuff like that. And we entertain the old folks, and they would pass a can around and put our little money in there. And that's what we did. So it was always a music thing with us.
And what would you do with the money?
Well, you know, for my candy or whatever we want, you know.
You go to the.
What are we going to do with the money? What are you implying?
I was thinking candy. What? Because when I was, I got some money. I was right out to Dairy Queen or to
exactly.
You know,
so that was.
Did you learn instruments? Did anybody play piano or?
I was a flute player.
Really?
I played flute. I think Linda did as well.
Did you play in band like in high school?
I actually played in my band. I played in the school band. And after I was influenced by Herbie Mann back then. You remember the jazz flutist?
Yeah.
And that was kind of cool back then. And so I did flute, but then I realized I was more interested in singing.
Yeah.
And eventually got into the singing thing.
Okay. And, you know, if I knew you played flute, I would say, get out your horn, man. Come on.
No, you wouldn't want to hear me play flute now. So you wouldn't. No, that was definitely way back.
All right. So in those days then, what was influencing you the most in singing and music? I'm guessing you like James Brown and some of the other local stuff. What
there were so many influences because we our parents played blues. We love blues. Of course, you know, if you ask me my favorite singers, it's hard to say. We had so many people to choose from. I love Stevie Wonder.
Yeah.
Bobby Bland. Donny Hathaway. I'm a big Luther fan, you know. Will Downing. I like that jazz kind of stuff. Yeah.
So have you ever thought about doing your own record?
You know, I took a shot at a couple of things in the CDs. And the thing about that for me is and you have to try to get somebody to get behind you to play and stuff like that. You finance these projects sometimes, and then you don't have a lot of time to work with it. Material gets old and that kind of thing. So I would love to do that again at some point as the clock is ticking, but it has to make sense.
Well, okay. There's
something I really want to do. Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to name like eight singers that are pretty much like the singers in the Bay Area. I only know, well, I know Linda, Larry Batiste, Clay Tovin, you, Fred Ross, Tony Lindsay. Is there anybody else? I mean, you guys are pretty much the guys. I mean, from what I know, in the Bay Area that have been the sort of the backbone, the singers that you always, that are just always the guys that are there singing, working, that you can call, that can sing. That's pretty much it.
There's Nick Beard. He's a great singer. There's a jazz singer. You know Nick Beard.
Yeah, I know Nick. And of course, there's Kenny Washington. But
Kenny Washington. It's not fair to say, you know. But it's so many good singers out there. But
you're being too modest.
I'm just trying to think of somebody I'm forgetting because you haven't named already.
No, well, those guys. Well, the reason I'm thinking of you guys.
There's a lot of younger singers that you don't know about. Talking about, that's what I'm having such a.
I see, but you guys have been there for. You've been there for the whole time, like from back, right? And that's sort of what I meant. Yeah. It's like when I would come up there and play. Well, who do you want to sing? Well, is Fred busy? Oh, is Calvin busy? Is Tony busy? Well, Clay Tovin. Oh, okay. Who else is there? Nobody. Of course, I don't know any of the young guys.
Yeah, there are other singers out here.
Yeah, I mean, there's just not that many singers that are just like guys that have always been there that you can count on that can deliver what you
do. Right.
You know, and are you still doing that thing, that top shelf thing?
Well, on occasion, I do that. Yeah.
And what kind of stuff is that?
It's more of a top 40 band. It's just a gig, the gig that we do for casuals, weddings, and that kind of thing. That's what I'm doing with that.
So, of all your experiences from the back then to now, what's been the most fun? The one thing that you just like doing and want to just keep doing all the time?
Musically, you mean?
Yeah. It doesn't even have to be music. I just like, you and I have spent time together. We've never really sit and talk. As a matter of fact, the first time I met you, I had you do a gig for me at Cache Creek. And, I'm kind of a talker and I'm kind of like, I'm like always spouting off at the mouth. Right. Right? And I'm like, come on, Calvin, come on, join the band. Come on. I got gigs. Remember
the guys with the money. What do you call it? The high rollers. Yeah, I remember that.
So we were sitting there and we were talking, and you're looking at me like, no, man, no. Like, you're like, no, you just really skeptical, And so we've talked, but there's a lot of stuff that I never really knew about you and all of the experiences you've had, because you've been singing for this, all you've done really is just sing, right?
Right.
Other than you mentioned you do stuff with kids. So tell me.
Well, yeah, I work with the school district. This is my 40th year with the school district. Jeez. As a counselor.
What?
Yeah. So that's my love as well. But yeah.
So singing is it. So you went to school at San Francisco State?
No. I didn't go to college here in San Francisco.
Oh, okay.
I didn't go to college at all, actually.
Then what do you do with the kids?
I'm a counselor.
And you've been doing that for 40 years?
For 40 years, man. And that happened to work out with my music as well, so it's a good contrast. So
what school district do you work in?
San Francisco.
And that's kind of a rough school district in some ways. Has it changed a lot over the years?
I wouldn't say it's rough. No.
No.
I don't think it's rough.
Is it how has it the public school system been? I mean, is it have they been getting funds? I mean, just because the Burbank school system with my daughter, they're having issues with money. Well, how is it in San Francisco?
Well, we've had some issues with our unions and stuff. on occasion. We just recently got a new contract just before the pandemic that's working out. But now we're going to have some serious problems with kids going back now.
Yeah,
because they want to take money away from these kids. This is going to take a special effort now to make this stuff work, the distance thing and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So that I don't, yeah. So at this, up until that happened, I guess things are pretty cool with the district.
So do you, what's the thing that kids have the most difficult time with? And it's in high school, right? Or middle school?
It's high school. High school. And I work at a continuation high school.
Uh-huh.
Special needs and stuff like that.
Okay. What's the most thing, the problem that seems to come up the most for these kids that you have to deal with that you wish you could help them with, or that you wish you could change for them?
Well, just the violence and then the environments they have, they're forced to be in, and mm-hmm. what goes on around them, you know, and you really feel for some of these kids, and they can't get out of that situation.
Mm.
And they end up getting, you know, going to juvenile and those places and stuff that keeps them in, you know, not good situations.
After you do that all week long, and then you go out and sing at nights and on the weekends, does that feel like a relief sometimes?
It is. It's a great contrast. Yeah, it is.
Because I'm just thinking, you know, I have a really soft spot for kids, and mm-hmm. especially if they have problems or problem homes or, you know, rough time themselves. And it affects me. Like just when my daughter has just even the smallest issue, I feel. Right.
Oh. Yeah. I know what you mean. Yeah.
Yeah. So
you feel for kids today.
Do you think this school will start this fall at all? I mean, what, any talk about that in your...
what can you say, Jeff? They're now they, because this thing is this pandemic, yeah. It's starting to go up now again. Yeah. You have no idea what they were going to do, because they don't want kids to go back if it's not safe. You can put a date out there and say, well, we're supposed to go back on the 14th
of August.
But that doesn't look like it's going to happen.
No, I can't see it.
No, you can't see it if it's not safe, man. You can't. Nah.
Yeah. I mean, if it happened, if they opened up, then, you know, all of the teachers would have to go, and you'd have to do the mask, and, you know, I mean,
we're trying to imagine how that's going to be.
Yeah.
How do you distance kids from each other? And everybody's wearing a mask all day, and you know, you can't have too many kids in one classroom.
Yeah.
So how's that going to happen?
Yeah.
So I have no idea what's going to happen with that.
Hey, do any of the, do you ever sing for at the schools or do any?
We've had, yeah, over the years, yeah, I have done music, yeah, stuff.
And do kids come and see you sing?
They probably don't want to come hear me sing. Our music and their music is like, I don't know about that stuff.
No, not now.
Maybe years back or something. Like, yeah.
So do you know Raul Fernandez? He's a friend
of Raul. Yeah, I know of Raul Fernandez.
You know, he says that Doc Kupka was a roadie for the Loading Zone.
He was. We listen. The Tower of Power sent Carlos Santana and all those guys used to come to our house all the time to eat and stuff, man, over in the Fillmore.
See,
they used to hang before these guys became famous and stuff. All those guys used to come around with Linda over there.
See, I didn't know that.
Absolutely, we know those guys way before that. Yeah, they were doing that kind of, yeah.
Well, what was that like? What was it, just like?
It was great. It was great. Yeah.
Man, and
over on Fillmore Street, yeah.
So, you, how far were you from Fillmore West? From
about 6 blocks.
Oh man, and they had music there all the time. Did you ever go down and try to sneak in and listen? And
I didn't have to sneak in. I went to all the concerts with Linda. Linda opened for Janis Joplin when she was 19.
Down there.
So yeah, and
you
was all, she was all, yeah. When I was a kid, she drugged me around with her to all the concerts and stuff like that. So, you know, I saw that for you know since I was you know real small.
Man, I'm telling you, you know, all I can relate to is the pictures that I see people show. But what those times were like? I'm just being in that environment. I'm just trying to imagine what it would have been like.
Oh, you would have loved the '60s, man. It's in the Bay Area, man.
Right? I mean,
you would have loved it. The Haight-Ashbury Sea, yeah, all of that stuff. We had the free concerts out in the park. Like Elvin Bishop, you name him, all these people just come out and just play for free.
You're just hanging. You know, they
Boskag, those guys all became stars, you know, so much later. But these guys, they were part of that, you know, the makeup.
And all of that stuff started in like what 66, 67, and then they started blowing up and becoming big by 69, 70 is about
started. I would say,
So Carlos and I mean. Yeah, and those guys, they were pretty young then when they were hanging around there.
Yeah. I think Carlos was at Mission High School and about 18, 19 years old.
Man. So do you still talk to him or anything?
No. Linda were great friends. I haven't seen Carlos Santana in many years.
Oh, man. Well, I mean, things have changed a lot now, but still, I'm just trying to imagine what it was like growing in those days with all of that stuff. Do you ever, wouldn't it be nice to have music that accessible again and have that kind of creativity? It just feels so different now than it was in those days.
Yeah. It's very different. Yeah.
Is there music in any of the schools that you work in and around? Are they have good music programs or
they do, you know, but they're into their rap and that kind of stuff. So they have music programs. You don't see kids playing instruments anymore. That's pretty bad. I mean, they're not in, you know, the orchestra, everybody, you know, when you got to high school, you couldn't wait to pick up an instrument to play the saxophone or the drums. Well, you don't see much of that kind of stuff anymore because everything's, turntables and just the rap music, that kind of thing. So
it's kind of like they think about music is created in your bedroom, mm-hmm. and you just make some beats, yeah. and you make some raps, and you're good.
Yeah, and they're getting paid.
They are getting paid.
These guys are getting rich off a beat, creating a beat. So how do you compete with that?
Oh, we make our own beat.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll make the beat, you start rapping.
Try doing both. There's some guys that can do that.
Yeah, man, I can't do it. So Wilson Brooks says congratulations on 40 years of working with the kids.
Tell Wilson hello and thank you so much, Wilson.
Yeah. And, you know, working with kids, it really takes something special, mm-hmm. and a kind of person. And this is the thing that really, when I meet you and when I'm around you, you're so quiet and you're so reserved and you just get up, you sing your songs, then you go and you sit down. And there's a depth of you that's soft. That nobody knows, nobody gets to see. That what I'm thinking is what those kids see. That there's that understanding part of you that sits with those kids and feels for them. That, you know, when we're out seeing and gigging with you, we wouldn't ever really notice because you just go and you sing your song and then you sit down and, you know, you don't really, we don't really discuss about some of all that stuff.
The school stuff, yeah. Well, that's my contrast. It's just when you're doing the school stuff, you're doing the school stuff. When you're with music and you're doing music. And
the other thing that
they both go together, yeah.
And you know, I never saw you get all linkered up or like, you know, smoking cigars and having brandy and all that kind of shit. You never did any of that stuff either.
Where were you?
Oh, I mean, that was
you on the break. Where were you on the break, man?
I was never around where the party was, so I always missed.
Well, let me know. I'll have my wine.
Oh, that, yeah, okay. So there was some times when you guys would have some wine and sit down. Oh,
yeah.
And so what was the last gig you did?
March 7th.
Jesus, man.
And man, it's just so weird. I haven't actually sang a song in 5 months. Is that crazy? I don't know what'll come out of this thing now.
Holy
cow. It's been 5 months since I actually sang a song.
Oh, man. I quit playing. I decided not to play anymore. And I don't miss playing, because you know what would happen is, like, with this time off, I wouldn't have picked up my sticks. Then I'd get called for a gig and I'd suck and I'd feel bad. Right. You know, so if I don't think of myself as a drummer, I don't even worry about making sure I practice or making myself feel guilty that I practice.
Right.
And it could be, how long could it be before we actually work again?
That's what's scary, because you have to think about this distancing. And people are doing this stuff online. But as far as an audience, when can you actually have an audience? And you know, that whole COVID thing with, what do you call it? Those the droplets and that kind of stuff.
Oh.
You have to be concerned about that. you know, all over stage, you can't get close to each other. And that, so it's, I don't know.
My daughter, Michaela, works on Broadway, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they closed down the theaters till next March. So that's a year of them off. And somebody said, well, can't they do theater by social distancing? And they're like, no, because the actors
together,
you know, and, you know, there's a bit, I guess you could do a concert and be sort of social distanced. But where are there places to even perform much these days?
I have no idea.
Yeah.
No idea.
If you could pick a band and put a band together right now that you could go play, who would be you call it to have in the band, and what kind of music would you do?
That would be a hard one. I don't know. It's hard to answer. It's hard to answer that
one. Fred,
I couldn't pick people.
Fred Ross says hi.
Hello, Freddie.
You wouldn't want to have Fred in the band. You wouldn't, because that would just...
Yes, I would. Actually, that's my brother. You know. that's my guy. It's my brother from another mother. I would definitely have Fred in the band.
Well...
But Fred, he knows all the cats. I'd actually have him pick the guys.
Oh, you'd have Fred pick the guys?
Yeah. Fred knows all the guys.
Yeah. You know, there's a few guys.
It wouldn't be fair to say I'd get this guy, get that. No, it's a lot of guys I would love to work with.
I want names. I want names, man.
No, I wouldn't do that. Not doing that.
Wilson goes, me.
Wilson would be one of the guys as well. Okay, thanks, Wilson. Thank you, brother.
Oh, man.
Putting me on the spot, dude.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm kind of like to stir things up once in a while, Calvin.
That's okay. That's okay. I can take it.
Yeah. So I think this is what you need.
Yes,
sir. You need to do your own live stream show. And you could sing a song and then talk with kids.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And have it like like little Zoom things with your kids at your school. And
okay.
Do
keep that in mind. Okay.
And just do a thing to interact with them and do just get a little music, have them all sit and like play something and sing to them. And you could use both of your skills.
You know, that very well might be the direction we're going in, you know? So that's a good idea. I mean, you know, again, we have to get back. We have to wait until we get back there and find out what's happening. That sounds like a good idea, Jeff, actually.
And this has given you your first lesson in live streaming.
Yeah, this is, I'm interested in see how this stuff's going. Because
it's going okay.
It looks like fun. It looks like a lot of fun. Yeah. Doing this stuff, yeah.
Well, you know, people are watching. Fred is here and Wilson and my friend Jocelyn is here from Phoenix. She tuned in to my shows. And, you know, there's people watching and this is fun. They like to interact with when you do it live, they can interact and make a comment and then we can comment on it. And if you record something, it's just not the same. So
and
I'm just thinking if this is a tool and a medium that we have to start using, there's probably a way that you could incorporate something, bring your music into things with your kids and bring.
I'm sure things are going to be happening like that in the future. Because,
you know, I mean, you really do have a good voice. You're a great singer and you should be singing and you need to maybe just create your own space for yourself.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay, Jeff.
Thank you. Come up there. Don't.
we don't want to do that. We don't want to do that in Nebraska. Fred, hold him back, Fred.
I threaten Fred. Don't make me come out to, you know, Fred. Fred will stick his cows on me.
What?
Fred's got, you know, he's got cows around his house.
He'll
stick his cows on me.
Why do you always want to just get yourself in so much trouble with people? you just enjoy it. you don't need to be messing with Fred, man. Leave Fred alone.
Fred, I told Fred.
I told Fred. Fred's going to turn into what? Okay.
I'm telling you.
Opened up a can on you.
I told Fred to not feel bad because he felt like I picked on him. He felt like I was picking on him, but I said no. I do the same stuff with Calvin, and I even told you. I told you what I always do, but I've been a little nicer. I've been nice. You know that the whole thing about you growing up. Linda dragging you around, opening for Janis while she was opening for Janis Joplin, seeing all those bands in the 60s there, and Carlos Santana and all those guys coming over to your house and hanging out, and then you growing up and singing with Bill Summers and Coke Escovedo and all of that. And then 40 years of teaching with kids. I'm like, man, there's just so much there. Then I'm really glad I was taking the time to ask you and talk to you and have you tell me about that. And not
thanks for having me. Time.
I haven't really messed with you too much.
Thank you, Jeff.
Yeah.
You spared me.
I mean, well, think, you know, that it's actually really cool that you've been able to sing your entire life and make a living at it. And
that's a blessing, man. That's a blessing.
Right. And be one of the best in the Bay Area, and you hang with all of the fellas. You hang with Fred and Tony and Larry Batiste and all those guys. You're one of the guys, and then have the 40 years of working with kids. I mean that's a lot, man. If anybody ever asked me what would you do, I would like to. I actually wouldn't mind being a counselor. For kids to be able to, you know, I think if a kid came with a problem and saying something and then you listen and then you just suggest something and then all of a sudden you see them go, oh, I never thought of that. And to see that light bulb go off, mm-hmm. I'm thinking, man, that would be really cool to be able to make a difference for a kid.
Sure.
Is there any significant child or somebody that you think you helped that really made, you'd said something to them that really changed the direction that they were going?
In all those years, yes, I have. And it just takes one. Mm. It just takes one. And sometimes you go out, you're out in the street and you feel like someone will walk up to you and say, Cal, I remember this happened. And if you hadn't told me that, and you don't remember it, you had no idea that it would have any effect on them. And they say things like that. And that's really touching, man. That really makes you feel like it was worthwhile what you're doing. Like I say, if you just touch one, you know what I mean? So yeah, there have been kids like that.
And that have come up to you after the fact and come up and go like, hey, Cal, remember
that
me?
They're adults now.
Wow.
Yeah, grandparents now.
Man.
And that's, that means a lot.
See,
that means a lot, man.
And here's the thing is, unless they come and run into us again and say something, we don't know.
You never know. You never know.
So
what effect you might have had on them, yeah.
And I'm just thinking, does it make you think about how you talk to people when you meet them sometimes, and you know, how you treat people?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that again?
Does it make, when you think of things about that way, about what you say, how it can affect people, does it make you think about when you're out and interacting with people, does it make you be more careful about how you talk to people?
Yeah.
Knowing that it might affect them.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. I mean, it doesn't help me a lot. I just give you shit anyway.
Yeah, you can't help that.
I'm sorry.
I keep you in prayer. you're only a Jeffrey.
I know. I can't help myself. See, so and do you go to church, and did you sing in church? Did you grow up in church?
Yeah, I did. I did some gospel. I actually did a couple of gospel albums at a time in my life. And
yeah,
I didn't grow up in church though.
Oh,
I didn't grow up in church, no.
But yeah,
I've had association with church.
Yeah, and maybe you and Linda should do a record together.
Well, I did some recording with Linda recently. She's doing some different projects, and my voice is on there, but I don't know exactly where that's going. That's her stuff. So,
oh, Fred just said praying for me doesn't help.
I know. I know. I'm gonna do it anyway. You're of the.
Well, oh man, all right. So
so
back to the records. This I got it. You record something with Linda, you start work doing the live stream stuff and working with kids, and then that'll help a lot of people get through the COVID-19 stuff. I think it's going to be at least a year before stuff normals out.
I certainly think that 2020 is a wash. I don't expect to work at all this year, to be honest with you.
Do you get anything from the union for unemployment and all that kind of stuff from the school?
You know what? Not during the summer for the 2.5 months. It's really weird. They won't pay you for that.
Mm.
But normally my music covers that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And now they have this pandemic unemployment situation for gig workers. I'm sure you know about that,
right? Yeah,
and that kind of thing. There, it's really weird. I'm dealing with that right now. But then again, if you have another job, they don't want to pay you for unemployment. It's That's really right. weird.
Yeah.
So they're sending me stuff here. If it happens, it happens. If not, no, it doesn't.
Yeah. I know. I was able to get unemployment relief as a self-employed person for 8 weeks, and then it was done.
Through your UI?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I just got another thing today. And what happens, these people, it's disaster relief, and they offer you $1,000 for free.
Really?
And you just, yeah, if you have a business and you're a gig worker or independent contractor, they offer you up to $150,000, and then that's the way to draw you in with this stuff.
Okay.
But you can't just, if you say I just want the $1,000, you actually get that.
Really?
Go ahead, Dave. I'm gonna finish your dinner.
All right. So is your dinner ready?
We're getting close.
Okay. What are you having for dessert?
I have no idea.
What's for dinner?
I've got to wait till I get over there. I'm going to start it. I'll see what it is.
There won't be any food left. I've got 50 more questions. I'm going down the list. I've only got to two so far.
Mm-hmm. See you.
What? So Calvin,
go ahead.
The $1,000, that's not really a lot, but it would help. It would help pay for something.
No, I'm just saying that's just one of the things that's out there for this relief stuff. It's, I figured, but a lot of people, that every little bit helps there. If they're just giving you that, I mean.
Right. Yeah. You know. All right. So I'm thinking while we're here, let's do a Christmas record.
A Christmas record?
Yeah, now's the time to start thinking. So, because by the time we get it,
Christmas. I don't know about that.
Take our mind off of all this stuff now. So that, you know, everybody records Christmas records in the middle of July because there's nothing to do in the middle of July. Right. And it takes a while to get it together.
Yeah, well, this is a different July. This was, I'm thinking about Christmas, right?
Oh, man. Well, so is there anything that I haven't asked you that you can tell me about the groups that you've sang with and that I may not know, because you've already told me some things that I was totally shocked of, like Will Kennedy playing in the band and, you know, hanging out with Carlos and all those things. And what am I missing? Is there somebody else that you know that I don't know about?
Not really. I mean, that's other things. I don't think they're that big of a deal. I think it's pretty much covered.
I mean, you've literally sang with practically everybody in the Bay Area, in all the bands. Anybody that you don't know.
A lot of bands, yeah.
Right? I mean, Wilson says he loves Christmas music. See,
I like Christmas music too, but.
Oh, come on, let's get it going.
Christmas album, but.
You know,
I'm not there yet.
Okay, so you know what's going to happen? Everybody witness this. The minute we hang up, Calvin goes eats. He's going to sit down. He's going to be eating. He's going to be thinking, you know, that Christmas record idea really isn't all that bad. Calling up Linda, and then we'll start singing. We'll get the Zoom thing going with the kids. We'll put them on the background tracks and have them sing like verses of songs. And next thing you know, you have this thing that's like, it's going to happen.
Seriousness, that's a good idea.
It could happen.
I'll keep that in mind.
Just put all the kids. You could almost just zoom them in. You have to have somebody edit the Rich knows about all that stuff. You know, Rich.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
he can help you out, and you just have all the kids. You know, and put a thing together, and you sing some songs, and you get it all together and make it a project for, you know, during the year or later on. You know, I mean, that way everybody participates, and you know, and it gets you everybody busy and thinking positive stuff. And
that actually sounds good. Yeah, that actually sounds good.
See, there's a whole reason we talked.
Yeah, you're good for something. Okay. Good for something, yeah.
All right. Well, you know, I'm gonna let you go eat. I want to. What's that? I want to play more of that. If I ever lose this heaven, because you know what? Mm-hmm. If I ever lose this heaven, I'll never be the same. I like that line. You know, when I used to be depressed, I don't know if you know this about me, but I'm kind of prone to depression. Mm-hmm. And there was a song, there was a Lionel Richie song that I listened to. There were three songs I listened to that helped me sort of really feel my pain and stay and then feel, get through it. was a Stevie Wonder song, Lionel Richie song, and If I Ever Lose This Heaven. And if, I would kind of go through and I'd listen. I've got, I feel bad. Then I start feeling better. And then like, oh, I'm feeling great. It, it was just something. So that's
Quincy and the Average White Band, their versions, I love them as well, man. It's just, yeah, it's just a great song.
Yeah. So I'm going to play a little bit more of that and close out the show. And see, we've already been 55 minutes sitting here talking.
You said that, whoa.
And your girl's over there like, hey, is this
ooh,
thing
you can talk? Ooh, dude.
Come on, dinner. Shut up. Get dinner, man.
Yeah, she's giving me that eye.
Okay. So, yeah, she's, well, oh, man, now I just lost my, there it is. Okay, I'm going to play this. And thank you, Calvin, for sitting and talking with me for an hour tonight. I really,
Jeffrey, thanks for inviting me, man. It was a pleasure.
Yes, and keep me posted on how the project goes with the singing with the kids.
I'm, you know, it's all seriousness, I'm going to keep that in mind, man, and see if we can do that. That sounds good. It really sounds good.
And yeah, it would be really cool.
Okay, you're good for something. You're good. Thanks. I'll take that one. For
something.
I'll write that one down.
All right. Hey, all right, everybody. Thank you, Calvin, for hanging out. I'm going to let him go eat dinner. And I'm going to keep playing this song. Have a good dinner.
Thanks, Calvin. Thank you, sir. Good night, you guys. The dark side of the
moon. How exciting. Then I'm still writing the book of love called you.